So I open up the console for the TACX Plus service, and you see, like, this is the output for the Docker container. I also want to see the packets as they flow through the TACX server, so to actually see what's going on in the exchange between the device. So I click on the link between the device and the TACX server and click on packet capture. I know TACX sits on TCP or runs on TCP port 49. So I put in a filter and say, I only want to see TCP port 49. TCP port 49. Say apply. So I'm on my edge switch here and I'm putting in the IP address of the access device that I want to log in. I hit return. And we see I get the TACX Plus authentication prompt. I see packets showing up on the right side with TACX packets. And I see on the TACX server, I see that there is an authorization query for my user here.
So you can run the controller inside of a CML, but if you want to connect to access points, you have to use the external connector and connect those physically into the access points to be able to do a wireless.
That's amazing. I mean, if you could do that, that would be amazing. So you can have Wi-Fi running within your laptop.
Yeah, entirely contained inside of a lab.
Maybe one more thing that is kind of interesting is the ability to do...
You're always too humble, Rolf. There's lots of interesting things.
Well, you know, we know this shit.
You can say that. That's going into the video. That's for sure. Everyone, David Bommel back with Rolf and Justin from the CML team. Guys, great to have you back on the show.
Yeah,
thanks for having us. So guys, give us an update. The latest version of CML 2.9, right?
So yes, 2.9 is the latest release.
So I want to know, guys, what's in it, Evie? Can you share some of like the updates and changes?
Absolutely. So 2.9, the important feature for 2.9 is container support. So container support means that we can run nodes that run Docker container images. So, and that is a huge thing for us because there is a lot of opportunity there for containers that are lightweight, provide some specific virtual functions, network functions, but also entire operating systems that are packaged these days as containers. And that is a lot better in some terms than virtual machines, but it's not going away. The virtual machines are not going away. It's just like a different option, which offers a lot more opportunity here in that
regard. So you can just pull down like Docker container type things into CML, is that right?
Yeah, we will be shipping with a couple of containers that we built into the product or that we ship with, like with all the other reference platform images. But you can also use like any container pretty much that is available on Docker Hub, or you can build your own. That's what we did for some of the containers that we ship with. Some of them are just vanilla containers that are coming from Docker Hub, like Nginx, for example. But we also have built a couple of containers that provide, let's say, a browser instance, just like a browser, Chrome, Firefox, that spins up in a second. And like little other things like a TACX container or a Radius container or some containers with network tooling. So things like that, that make your life as a learner, as a network engineer, easier. There's another thing, and Justin will probably talk about that one, that is the sample apps, right?
Yeah, so we've got a lot of feedback from our users where they want to be able to do more with pre-built labs. So they're going for CCNA, CCNP, CCIE. Obviously, you can build your own lab the way you want. Up to this point, we've had a few pre-baked labs inside of CML. But what we've done is we've taken the labs that exist in GitHub currently, and we've included those inside of CML. So you'll have a new sample apps interface. You'll be able to go in there and you'll be able to open those sample labs inside of CML. Additionally, if you have your own GitHub repo, you can add that as an additional repository and pull in your own sample labs from there.
So I could create a whole bunch of CCNA labs on GitHub and then a student could just pull it down.
Correct. Yeah.
That's great.
Exactly. Yep.
That's great.
So it could be something like for you, for your content, but it could also be like in a school or like university, yeah, network training, whatever. You have your specific sample labs for your session or for your class, right? And that could be made available within a product where the sample labs are. And we're going to show this in a minute.
So Rolf, great to talk about it, but can you show us the Docker stuff?
Absolutely. We have a little example here that just illustrates the use of that Docker thing. And that is, by the way, something that can be easily run within the free version. So it's because of the lightness of those container images and the images that we ship with. You can do something like this in the free version, which is like a really good use case to learn. For example, in this case, TACX.
Does it does the Docker container count towards the license?
It does.
Okay.
So the Docker container, everything right now counts against the licensing, like the container images. Yeah. So that's just the nature of the game.
But then you can still do a nice lab.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, this here, as you can see, is just a bunch of random nodes here. So there's nothing really, meaningful in a way that it represents an actual network. It has here some outside connectivity. It has a router here that I can log into. And then it has an access switch. So this access switch here is actually configured to use TACAX. And we have a TACAX server running up here, right? And so when we log into, or like when we open up this guy here on the console, so I open up the console for the TACAX Plus service, and you see like this is the output for the Docker container, like the log file of TACAX basically. And what's showing here is something that has been done before. So like someone logged into that device. So and now I'm going to open up this guy here. Another, let's do plus here. So I'm now on this device that is sitting before the device that uses the TACAX authentication. And maybe one more thing, I also want to see the packets as they flow through the TACAX server. So to actually see what's going on in the exchange between the device. So I click on the link between the device and the TACAX server and click on packet capture. And I open it up on the wrong thing. So I put it over here and then I say, okay, I know TACAX sits on TCP or runs on TCP port 49. So I put in a filter and say, I only want to see TCP port 49, TCP port 49, say apply. So I'm on my edge switch here and I'm putting in the IP address of the access device that I want to log in. I hit return. And we see I get the TACAX Plus authentication prompt. I see packets showing up on the right side with TACAX packets. And I see on the TACAX server, I see that there is an authorization query for my user here. So I put in, I think it's tag admin. And admin 123 is the password that I've configured. And now I'm logged in and I can see the login success on the side on the TACAX server, right? So this is a very simple example that runs within the 5-node limitation of the free version, where I just use a simple network service, TACAX, and use this for training purposes. I can see the packets on the right-hand side. I can click on the packet, and I can see that this is TCP port 49, and it shows me this is a TACAX conversation that is going on here.
I like that. That's great. Nice little demo.
And you know, this is just one example. We have a container for Radius doing the same thing with a different piece of software, different daemon. But the other thing is that we also can do, let's put this up here in the screen. We can do, let's say, VNC, a browser that runs in a container. So if I start and stop this thing, so if I stop this and start it again, this is pretty much instantaneous. I mean, this runs within, I mean, it doesn't have network connectivity, but you see that the window comes up instantaneous, right? So that's the benefit of having containers in there.
So how do I get the containers into CML?
So we ship with a bunch of containers as part of the reference platforms, but you can also create your own. I have a little write-up that we are going to publish with the documentation that shows you, we don't ship with Grafana. Grafana is like a what is that thing? A visualization thing of network things or events. I probably said it wrong, but anyway, you get the idea. So it's some service, right? And we don't ship with that because we probably cannot bundle it. It's not our software, right? But you can download that thing from Docker Hub. And my little documentation says, okay, here's the steps, how you can pull something from Docker Hub and make it a CML node, a node definition so that you can run such a thing as a container within CML.
Justin, have you guys got a demo of the sample labs as well? It's built in, yeah.
So sample labs, they live at the same place as they used to be. So we go to the menu here, the tools menu, and then sample labs in here. And as you can see, there is a bunch of sample labs that are like roughly 30 or so that are built into or like, you know, actually pulled in from a GitHub repository and show up in the product right now. There's a nice feature where you could click on one of those and it shows you a preview on the right hand side. So you can see like, what does it look like? It shows annotations for some of those. And it also can include some documentation. So in this example, there is like the lab documentation or the lab description shows up here. And in the bottom half, you see like what this lab looks like, including the annotations, if there are any. And then you could simply click on import lab and import the lab. So if I click on one of these labs, let's say this one, an import lab, it has imported into CML and you can work with it instantaneously. So, and this is, you can tailor the content that your students work with and put that into a GitHub repository. How it's configured, you go to tools, system administration, obviously something that only an administrator can do, and then go to lab repositories. And you have here, you can see the name of the repository, the URL that it pulls from, and the folder that it puts the stuff in there. So you could remove this or add more, or you can also refresh the content in case it has changed on the remote end.
Which versions of CML have that?
This is a 2.9 feature.
Sorry, I mean, do you need, is it in the free version or is it like the, which version
is
it?
It's in all versions. It's all versions.
Yeah, all of them. Oh, brilliant. I love that because, I mean, I'm obviously selfishly thinking of what I do. Like I could create a bunch of CCNA labs, put it in a course, and rather than like making it difficult, students can just pull it down.
Yeah, and you can always do GitHub pulls to request. So if you want to, we always encourage people if they build stuff and they can add up to the repository and we can import those.
That's brilliant. That's
the one,
great.
The one that we ship with, the one that's showing right here, that's the one that is the CML community where we have a lot of other things related to CML, like additional node definitions and you know, scripts and documentation pieces, instructions to install it on other platforms, which is also something that might be interesting for people, your audience, where we have instructions to install it on Windows using Hyper-V or Nutanix or Proxmox, right?
Yeah, so I'll put the link below so that you can go and get that. Yeah, that's brilliant because it's, you know, people often struggle just to get started, right? So that's brilliant.
Yeah, and then some other minor things, or maybe one more thing that is kind of interesting is the ability to do...
You're always too humble, Rolf. There's lots of interesting things.
Well, you know, we know this shit.
You can say that. That's going into the video. That's for sure.
We know this stuff inside out, so it's kind of hard to describe what's interesting for other people and what is not.
That's
right?
Going
to
be the intro.
Dude. Anyway, so but the one more interesting thing is the ability to do image snapshots. So what that means is that if I have an Ubuntu node, for example, right, and I do some modifications to that Ubuntu node, maybe I install some software inside of that Ubuntu node, right, or make modifications to that Ubuntu node, and I want to persist those modifications, I would have to use either CloudInit and do that all the time I start up that node, or I would have to have some ways of persisting the image, the disk of that node. And that's a feature that we have built into 2.9. So you basically can, let's say you install software on Ubuntu,
yeah,
and then you say, hey, I want to snapshot that state, right, and make it a new image for that particular node. So you snapshot it, it shows up as an additional image, and when you start or when you add another node, you can select that image, and the software package that you installed previously is already on, right? So that's another feature.
Can you show us?
Yeah, sure. So that's, again, something that only the administrator can do. So you don't want to have like a regular user. Like if you're not an admin, you don't want to have that happen just for any user, right? So you have to have admin rights. So let's say we have an Ubuntu node on here. So you click on that node, and then you have this button up here that says save as image, right? And with that save as image, it will capture the state of the disk and create a new image that you can select then further on for Ubuntu nodes in this particular case. One restriction, you have to have the node in stopped state. So it needs to be stopped to be able to save the image. Otherwise it won't work. But that's yet another like nice thing. And then there's maybe two more things that we wanted to show here, which is more on the UI quality of life kind of things.
All right, so one small thing that has been added in 2.9 is the ability to see the IP addresses, assuming that the node is connected to an external connector. So if I come under the node here and go into the interfaces tab, you can see the IP address that is assigned on that interface. So if my nodes are connected to the internet, I'll be able to see the address. Is that what?
It has to be L2 adjacent to an external connector.
Okay.
So if the external connector hands out an IP address to a node inside of CML, we have a component that is called IP snooper. So it listens, yeah, on the wire and it recognizes, hey, there is a node that talks on this particular IP address. So it picks it up, and we can always, or like in the past, it was always possible to retrieve the content or like the information using the API, right? And that's also being done for PaDI, for example, like the other way of access. Well, and now it's being built into the user interface. So you can see that like by the click of your mouse, and see, hey, this device has actually picked up this IP address, which was a bit more complicated than the past. You had to go to the CLI of the device and do like an IP address or something, you know.
All right. And so one other thing that we've changed in 2.9 is we've added this ability to change the fonts for consoles. So you can come under the tab here, go to global console settings. And down at the bottom here, we have font family. So you can select a different font family.
So that's great. Because I mean, often this font's really small, right? On the console. So now you can make it quite big.
It's not about the size. So we've had font size in previous versions. So you can change the font size here. And maybe some users don't actually know that this global console settings exists. But clicking on a tab, once you have a console open, you can pull up the global console settings. And then in current versions, you can change the font size. But we've added this font family. You can also change the theme. This has always been in CML as well, but you can change the color. So there's a couple of pre-built ones. There's like a retro one if you want it like a yellow or orange or Cisco blue. So you can save that and then you can see the different colors.
Didn't you say you added this, Ralph, because you had a special type of font that you liked?
Yeah. I mean, that was exactly the reason. You know, like there's this like, I want it the way I want it, right? And I like, you know, JetBrains, the mono font for coding, and I wanted to have JetBrains in there as well. So yeah, and other people like other fonts, right?
It's usability.
I want to have a different desktop background or something of that nature, right? So this is what we did. We allowed you to. We have a couple of fonts in there that should be available on most systems. You know, some monospace fonts. But you could put in the name. So it's actually like not only a dropdown, you can also put in your individual font name. And as long as it exists on your system, it shows just fine. So it's a quality of life thing.
I love it. I mean, you're a Linux user. I would expect something like that from a Linux user.
Yeah, ex-Mac user.
Love it. Now guys, this is fantastic, but I'm pretty sure a lot of people would love to have Wi-Fi. Is that even possible in CML? And, you know, is it possible to add something like that?
It's not currently possible today, but it's something that we're definitely looking into. We have a couple of proof of concepts that we've been working on to try to get that in, but it's definitely not on the roadmap currently, but it's something that we're looking into.
So when you say that, is it possible, like, if you guys are working on this, hopefully this might come one day. There's no commitments, obviously, but you'd have a controller and then APs.
Yeah, so today you can do a virtual wireless LAN controller, and with 2.29, we're going to ship with the 9800. So you can run the controller inside of a CML, but if you want to connect to access points, you have to use the external connector and connect those physically into the access points to be able to do a wireless.
That's amazing. I mean, if you could do that, that would be amazing. So you can have Wi-Fi running within your laptop.
Yeah, entirely contained inside of a lab.
So that would be amazing.
That gives you a lot of opportunities, especially like there are certifications targeted for wireless and like a lot of training interest, like people training wireless. If you have actual radios for a ton of students in a same classroom, lots of interference. So if there is a way to virtualize all of that,
that'd be amazing. So for everyone watching, put comments below. What do you think about that feature? If you would really love to have that, let us know. Put in the comments below. It'd be great if you can get that authorized and working. That'd be brilliant. Fingers crossed.
And then there's, since Justin brought it up, with 2.9, there will also be new reference platforms. One of them being the wireless LAN controller he just mentioned, the 9800. And the other one is ICE. So we will include the ICE image in 2.9. But to be honest, I mean, that is still a hefty beast. It requires 16 cores, 16 CPU cores,
wow,
and 16 gigabytes of memory. But for the people who have those resources, we include the image. So
yeah, I don't know how applicable that is for your audience, because it is such a beast. I think a lot of your audience is more people getting into like,
no, I think
intro.
I think it's going to be people who want that.
Yeah,
no, that's great. I mean, feel free to share. I mean, everyone who's watching, let us know if you like that. I know there's been a lot of comments about like wanting certain types of things in CML. So it's, yeah, let us know. Anything else that you guys have added that you think might be of interest or that have been requested that you've now added?
I don't think so. That's it.
Brilliant.
Well, we have to have something for the next version, right?
Love it. Thanks so much for coming, guys.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.